Kia ora tātou, kia ora katoa. Greetings and welcome everyone. My name is Peter Grant. I'm a singer, musician and entertainer. On behalf of Kia ora koutou mā, I'd like to thank you all for joining us this morning for our Māori program Te Karanga o Te Kōwhai here on Radio 4EB 98.1 FM. And as you've probably guessed by now, I'm no one famous, nor do I have a high profile. I guess that's evident because only a handful of you listening have ever heard my name before. But in spite of that, let me assure you, I'm excited to be on air with you this morning. And if you're with me thus far, I'd like to share my journey of 56 years as an ordinary working musician here in Australia, New Zealand, the Pacific Islands, and Asia. I trust it'll be interesting, informative, and entertaining for you. During my career as a professional performer, I've had the great privilege of working with some incredibly talented people who have had no recognition whatsoever. As it is with me, the majority of the names I mention you will not recognize. So I've entitled this broadcast, and the ones that will follow, The Life and Times of Nobody Famous. So in this series of programs, I'd just like to honour those unsung legends of the Australasian music industry and confirm my gratitude and thanks simply by speaking their names out loud to the world through this media platform that has been made available to me through my dear friend Vic Kenner, of whom you will hear more of in coming episodes. And I pay tribute to him and all the others as they have helped me achieve a childhood dream. As always, I think the best place to start is from the beginning, and from the very beginning, so here goes. I grew up in Rotorua, New Zealand, as a child, and was enrolled in Whang Marino Māori School, as it was labelled back then in the 50s. And then around the age of 11, we moved into town, into the Rotorua Intermediate School. Then finally, onto Rotorua Boys High School, where I basically failed everything except playing the wag, or hooky as some may say. More about that later. The first song that I can recall that really had an impact on me was Jailhouse Rock. I was about 8 years old. My brother and I were whirling around in a merry-go-round in a local paddock at Moria, where my cousins lived. I can still smell the diesel, fumes from the small motor, and as the exhaust seemed to keep time with the music. That was it. I saw a guitar in a farmer's catalogue. A farmer's was a department store in Auckland. So I wrote a very convincing letter to Santa stating why he should bring me one for Christmas. Look, he must be real, because on Christmas morning there it was under the tree. Well, it laid around the house basically as a toy for when my cousins would come to visit and got bashed around and thrown back in the wardrobe after they'd gone home. This continued for a few years until one day my dad took it to a party. Sadly, it never came back home again. Well, such is life. So it was back to playing my dad's Shadows records. While doing all the steps, imitating Hank and Bruce, the sticks and guitars in front of the record player, we thought we looked and sounded deadly, as we could sing every guitar line that we had stored in our memory bank. My dad and uncle were musicians, not professionals, but both played in a military dance band during World War II. And for some post-war years, I guess somewhere deep down in the pocket of my genes was some musical determination waiting to be expressed. My dad played sax and my uncle played clarinet, and both played guitar. But later, Dad favoured the steel guitar, and he loved to play Hawaiian music. And he'd sit in his bedroom for hours and play Billy Wolfgram tunes note for note. You know, when my uncle and dad would get together and at a rare family gathering, after a few beers had kicked in, my aunties would join them, singing in sweet, beautiful harmony all the Daphne Walker songs that they could muster. You know, that wonderful sound is etched in my memory, and it will be until the day I shuffle off this mortal coil, I have to say that. Yep, I confess hearing these songs after all these years has taken me right back to those innocent childhood days, and you know, when the power of music had wiped away every care and woe that they all must have been carrying. And there we were, you know, all us kids sitting on the floor in awe, listening and watching Dad. And, well, Rab was his nickname, I don't know how he got that. But anyhow, Uncle Hinger, Auntie Winnie and Auntie B, totally engrossed in the moment as they sang and played from the depth of their souls as one beautiful spirit. And I admit that memory, my friends, has brought a tear to my eye. Dad was just 17 and Uncle Hinger was 18 when they went to war to fight for the freedom we now enjoy. They were in the 28th Māori Battalion B Company. My dad was heavily traumatised by the terrifying ordeal and was sent back to NZ for shell shock treatment, which he never really received. His brother was still fighting in the Middle East, so he changed his name and returned to the front line, found him, and they stood and repelled another enemy onslaught together, truly as brothers in arms, once again.
Maori Battalion march to victory. Maori Battalion staunch and true. Maori Battalion march to glory. Take the honour of the people with you.
Praise God, they both returned safely and, you know, with no missing arms and serious injury. You know, tragically, their injuries were unseen. You know, and I can only guess, but would safely say that the absolute horror of war, the heat of battle, and the recurring flashbacks of helplessness they must have endured, of not being able to help and comfort those poor souls, brothers, cousins, childhood mates they'd grown up with, you know, that had been blown apart and left dying in front of their very eyes, disfigured and lying, dying beside them. Mere boys locked into battle, standing against an enemy as fighting machines, killing strangers who, like them, wishing they were back home, eating a meal with whānau and sleeping in a nice, clean, warm bed. Now that terror and the badness would haunt them both day and night. Neither one ever be the same person they were when they left the shores of Aotearoa. But having said all that, the trauma that my dad suffered isolated him from us all. It isolated him from his family, including my mum. And he and I were never close. You know, he passed nothing of what he knew musically onto me. Although we lived in the same house, I barely knew him. And I was scared to ask him to show me anything, and he never offered, although Mum said she repeatedly asked him to. 1961 had dawned and I'd been on the earth for just over a decade. My brother and I had settled into our new place of learning, Rotorua Intermediate School, a big adjustment compared to Whangmarino. But those relatively innocent days were to turn to custard in the twinkling of an eye. Yes, indeed. while Peter Poser was on the pop charts with his guitar instrumental White Rabbit. Elvis was asking some chick to surrender in his sweet silky tone, asking her, "Are you lonesome tonight?" And the Drifters were probably asking the same chick to save the last dance for them, but with Big Bad John at the top of the charts, I watched in disbelief as my brother went flying through the air, hit by a car while crossing the road into the school grounds. Praise God, he survived and lived to tell the tale.
Big John, Big John.
Every morning at the mine you could see him arrive. He stood 6 foot six and weighed 245, kind of broad at the shoulder and narrow at the hip. And everybody knew you didn't give no lip to Big John.
Big John, Big John.
Big Bad John.
Now, my parents had just gotten over that ordeal, and I just realised I haven't, because as I relay the story, I get all shivery and, yeah, never really had any counselling about that. I just was just quite a childhood trauma that never got dealt with, never been dealt with. But anyway, moving on. But, you know, life went back to normal and, you know, sort of out of the blue, almost in the same spot where my brother got hit. My legs wouldn't work anymore, and there I sat in the gutter in the pouring rain, unable to walk. And like, we used to walk from my grandfather's place of work. We'd come in the mornings in the car with him. We were always sort of got there early, so we used to walk down to the school. And you know, I couldn't walk anymore, as I said, and my brother got me to my feet, and I put my arm around his neck, and painfully, with his help, I dragged those sort of lifeless legs to the school. And the finer details of that are just sort of just a blur, but there I was, next minute, lying on my back in the hospital bed, with the doctors instructing me to stay still as possible, and under no circumstances to get out of bed. So I had a sort of, you know, wee and poo in bed, which I was a sort of didn't really warm to that idea, but I had to adjust. That lasted for 6 months, and then slowly I was rehabilitated and got back to my feet and got to walk again. But I was sort of no stranger to this, because when I was actually 6 years old, I was struck down with polio. And yet again, the hand of God was upon me, and I got through that unscathed. While I was laid up in hospital, bored to tears, I might add, I met an older boy. His name was Edward George from Horohoro. Horohoro is a farming district a few miles south of Rotorua, and it's sort of a dairy farming, maybe sheep, I think, too, area. And Edu could play ukulele. And although I was, you know, forbidden to get out of bed, I was, you know, supposed to be laying still, I begged him to teach me some chords, and he'd come around now and again and show me stuff. And I wished he could have come around every day, to be honest. But soon after our counter, he was released from hospital and went home. And I've never seen him from, or heard of him from that day till this, and he just disappeared into the ether. But now, with hindsight, I realised the hunger to play an instrument was stirring down deep in my soul. And by the time I left the hospital, I could play Chubby Checker's The Twist.
Come on, baby, let's do the twist. Come on, baby, let's do the twist. Take me by my little hand and go like this. Yeah.
Man, I was over the moon, you know, The Twist, I could play it. But, you know, disappointed that Edu and his ukulele were gone. Well, 61 rolled into 62, and I was in a class with a boy whose name I will never forget. His name was Trevor McClelland. Now, old Trev, he'd blow me away because he could play the honky-tonk like anything. No, that's just still a Mark Knopfler saying, but line. But he could play guitar boogie, man. He just blew me away. So, old Trev used to leave his guitar in the storeroom of the classroom, and the storeroom was always kept locked because the teacher had some of his belongings in there as well. Yeah, so because, like I said before, my brother and I would get to school early. We'd get there before anybody else because Papa, as we lovingly called him, my granddad, he started work at 7:30, so we walked, like I said, from his work down to the school. So there was nobody at the school when we arrived there, and we used just to hang around, and the classrooms were open by the time we got there. And these buildings were a temporary thing. They had an open plan type of deal, and you walked into them, and there was a cloakroom where we hung all the bags and coats and stuff. And then I realized that I could climb up into the ceiling and walk along the ceiling and down into the storeroom where Trev kept his guitar. And so then I'd spend a half an hour or so in there, and during that time I learned a song by Ann Sheldon called Sailor, transferring those chords that Edward taught me on ukulele onto the fretboard of Trev's guitar.
Sailor, stop your roaming.
That was released in 1961, the year before. So to me, that effort was well worth it. With the Twist, Sailor, and a few others I had learned before the end of the school year in my little closet there, I was ready to rock and roll. Yeah. The first week of high school, I met a guy called Turi Giddies and his brother Robert. They lived across the way from the school, across Old Topol Road and in La Trobe Place. And it was only 2 minutes walk. So we'd spend our lunchtime over there playing guitars and listening to music. We'd toast my sandwiches and that Mum had packed, and drink cups of tea and eat anything that was left over from their parents' fridge. And you know, it got to the point where these lunchtime sessions would go beyond the bounds of normal school time regulation. And sometimes they'd last in the morning until all day, you know. So and then I'd be climbing on the bus at 3 o'clock and heading home, and no one was any the wiser. And I think Mum and Dad Gillies were oblivious to the antics of their sons and their adopted son. And I've got a lot of respect for those two, especially Mr. Gillies, who's the only remaining member of the 28th Māori Battalion, and served with my dad. And I think last I heard he was 98, so I'd probably be 99 by now. God bless him. It was only a year had passed since intermediate school, and music hadn't changed much. The Four Seasons were at the top of the charts, and January 1963 with Big Girls Don't Cry. Then went to Frank Ifield, the Aussie boy, Four Seasons there again at number three with Big Girls Don't Cry. The old mate Chubby Checker was in there with Limba Rock. Rooftop Singers, Walk Right In, Walk Like a Man, Four Seasons, Cliff Richard in there. It was a sort of still a pretty ordinary type of playlist there, except for the Beatles, of course, who had been pretty predominant through the year of 63, I Want to Hold You and She Loves You and all that sort of caper. But the Rolling Stones hadn't even had a song in the charts in New Zealand anyway at that stage. But things sort of were about to change in the next few years to come. But you know what? When I think about it a little deeper, school was just a place that I had to be. And now, as I sort of look back on the path that I've taken, jamming at the Gillies place was probably far more beneficial to me than attending school and the subjects I had no interest in whatsoever. Now, I'd already hooked up with Max McDonnell from Holden's Bay. You know, he was the man. You know, he had an amp and a guitar and a mohawk haircut. But, and he knew Keith Ballard, who had shoulder-length blonde hair, a red drum kit. That was it. We were a band. Look out, Rotorua, here we come. PG and the Perils is coming to get you. But I had some catching up to do, both in the hair department and with gear. Well, the boys and I concurred that the only way to rectify the gear thing, at least, was to go on bended knee, cap in hand, to my mum and Nana and ask for the money. With all the conviction and sincerity I could muster, explain the essentials one must have to be a real guitar player. And if that don't work, bro, they said, as a last resort, grovel, beg and cry. Thankfully, no groveling, etc. was necessary, as they warmed to the needs of this budding musician's request. And by the next week, I was playing a Jansen Invader Strat copy, powered by a Jansen 620 amplifier that proudly sat on a cab with two 12-inch speakers. But yeah, there was still some resistance to the hair thing. But I must say this, for the record, without their support and tolerance, my journey would never have started. Now, Keith had had enough of having no bass player, so he quit and joined one that did. What a cheek! Anyway, high school mate Tom Cochran puts his hand up. Great player, and man, he could sing too. The vote was yes, so he was the third peril. The Beatles hit the scene and were blowing our socks off, and the Shadows, they were still hanging round and round. So PG and the Perils would get together on a Sunday at Max's house and rip into it. At the ripe old ages of 13 and 14, like, we believed we had money to burn, man, and some left over to impress the chicks. But Max's dad had other thoughts. Now, he was a lot older than my dad and most other fathers of mates our age. He'd freak out if anything got louder than a butterfly fart. So in the middle of Max smashing out a solo, the power would go off, and Max's dad had pulled the plug out of the wall from the hall where we'd run the lead out into the hall. And man, we were playing some serious stuff there. So Max would storm out and there would be a heated exchange of words, and on would go the power. We'd be cooking away again, then off it'd go again. And this carried on, and anyway, till it got to the point where Max's dad would storm out of the house and go to his mate's place, have a few beers to chill out. Up to this point, we had no bass player. So my brother Nuka was given the job. But he asked, mind you, but he reluctantly accepted. But he had no interest in playing guitar to start with, and even less in playing just the bass. Nor did he own one. But Mum and Nana came up to to our aid once more, and that was it. Nuke was in as our bass player, with a new bass as well. He tolerated the repetition of rehearsal, but just wanted to play it once and get out of the room and go and play football, as that's where his heart lay, not playing in some dumb band. All his prayers were answered in an unusual way. He and I got into a fight one night regarding his lack of interest in rehearsal. After all, this was going to be the band that was going to take down the Beatles. He reckoned Max and I were full of it, and the music was crap.
I told him he better pull his finger out and believe the dream. As Max had already written one song, he said, "You're a stink guitar player anyway." I threw a punch. Missed, lost my balance, and fell onto the bass that was leaning on the chair. Snapped the neck from the body. Well, that was it. Back to being a bassless band.
Well, no one told me about her, though they only...
But the fame of the PG and the Perils was very short-lived. Max had decided he was going to go professional. So he packed his bags and headed to the bright lights and the big smoke of Auckland.
Well, let me tell you about the way she looked, the way she had to have the colour of her heart. Her voice was soft and cool, her eyes were clear and bright.
Eventually, 1963 turns into 1964. With the demise of the Perils, it forced me to network, get out and to know different players outside of my usual circle, broaden my horizons and take interest in what they were doing and soak up all the knowledge I could. I went to a restaurant one night to listen to Joe Daniels, who was an apprentice mechanic where my grandfather worked. He played a lot of instrumental songs like Rambunctious, Wheels, Red River Rock, Cherry Pink and Apple Blossom White, all the great tunes I wished I could play. But the tide was about to turn and popular music would explode into a whole new direction and take me and my friends with it. Joe was a fantastic player and a beautiful man who would go out of his way to say hello, have a chat anytime he saw me. Many of the songs that he sang were from the 50s, but that was okay. I'd heard them over and over as a kid. And besides, many of them were still getting airtime and they were great songs to boot. But the tide, my friends, was only at ebb at this stage. Well, hardly any time at all had passed, really, and I found myself crammed into a decked-out garage in Orfata, auditioning for Ron and Steve Utatonga and Willie Henderson. Ron was a great player and knew all the popular instrumentals, and we all could sing, so I said, why not? Let's have some fun. We would play at football social functions. That seemed more like a boxing wrestling match at times. But local dance halls, you know, school socials, etc. And we got to be really tight, a really tight unit. And just four blokes out there getting off playing music. So much so that we didn't even have a name.
How? Let's begin a how. Watch how strange can be. Little red roosters on the prowl. If you see my little red rooster.
Okay, folks, I think this is a good spot to pull up. I trust what I presented has been of interest to you, and hopefully it hasn't been too boring. But I felt it necessary to set a platform from which to start that will give you a bit more insight into who and where this nobody came from. From where we just left off, I really had no idea where I was going or what I wanted to do. But the next 5 years would prove a time of learning that would catapult me into a world that, you know, may as well have been low Earth orbit, but would launch me into years of ever-evolving, non-stop learning, thus spitting me out to where I am at this very moment. I'd like to play the session out, folks, with a piece of music entitled Fusing from two great and dear close friends of mine I have the privilege of knowing, Steve Keeley and Richard Goldner. And may I say, folks, that friends like these I can count on the fingers of one hand. Thank you all once again for joining us this morning on our Māori program, Te Karanga o Te Kōwhai, and I sincerely look forward to your company once again in a month's time. And hopefully from now on, I'll be your favourite nobody. Cheers, everybody. Peter Grant. Here on Radio 4UB 98.1 FM.